When I was asked to introduce our next speaker, Reverend Father William Saunders of Our Lady of Hope Catholic Church, I must admit, I was quite overwhelmed by my assignment. There are many ways I can introduce him. I can call attention to the fact that he is simply brilliant, evidenced by graduating valedictorian from West Springfield High School to graduating summa cum laude from St. Charles Borromeo Seminary, after successfully completing his bachelor's in business administration in accounting at the College of William and Mary. I could harp about how he is a famous author and columnist at the Arlington Herald, where his Straight Answers is widely read and referenced by people with questions about the Catholic faith. I could brag about his pastoral ministry, how he was the pastor of multiple parishes before building Our Lady of Hope Catholic Church and School from the ground up, and how his masses are well attended and full, especially for those serious Catholics who wish to hear the beautiful truth about our faith through his engaging and funny homilies. But none of these comes close to the Father Saunders my family and I have known and loved my entire life. Father Saunders baptized me into the faith and taught me the faith during my elementary school days at Our Lady of Hope Catholic School. Father Saunders has the remarkable ability to explain the faith in ways that even a kindergartner can understand, and he has an amazing memory. He knew every kid in our school by name, but that also meant that he knew when I missed Mass. He may come across as stern to some, but I know just how merciful he is when he allowed me to be an altar server even after I pulled the fire alarm when I was 2 years old during consecration. He is funny, wise, kind, and a true inspiration and role model for me. I am who I am because of the influence of this great man of God. Please welcome Reverend Father Saunders.
Well, that was very kind. And the fire alarm incident is true. At that time, we were homeless. We were having daily Mass at the Lutheran church. And there was a little baby named Paulo, 2 years old, and he yanked the fire alarm. Well, anyway, here we are. So, my topic is fighting for religious freedom and freedom of religion. Very important. President Reagan said, "Freedom is never more than one generation away from extinction. We didn't pass it on to our children in the bloodstream. It must be fought for, protected, and handed on for them to do the same. Or one day we will spend our sunset years telling our children and our children's children what it once was like in the United States where men were free." How true. And I can say it's true as I have lived now 61 years and I think of how I grew up and the environment I grew up in, not just in Catholic school, but also public school, versus what you all face today. Freedom of religion truly has to be fought for, protected, and handed on. You and I cannot take this for granted. For good reason, when we look at our Constitution, the First Amendment of what we call our Bill of Rights reads, "Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof or abridging the freedom of speech or of the press or the right of the people peaceably to assemble and to petition the government for a redress of grievances." But go back to the beginning. "Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof." Virginia. How many of you are from Virginia? Good number. How many are not from Virginia? Okay, how many of you are from what would be the original 13 colonies? Very good. Did you know that at one time it was illegal to be a Catholic in the 13 colonies? Hard to believe. Most people don't recognize that. But it's for this reason, this great premise of freedom of religion, that Virginia did not ratify the Constitution until June 26, 1788, and only after James Madison, a Virginian, promised that there would be this Bill of Rights and include in Amendment Number 1 First thing, freedom of religion. So let's take our minds back. Virginia was founded in 1607, Jamestown Colony. It was a crown colony. Jamestown was named after King James I of England, and we have Virginia named after the Virgin Queen, Elizabeth I. When Jamestown had its official charter in 1609, the charter read that every citizen of the colony had to take the oath of supremacy, meaning that the person had to say, "I believe that the king or queen is the head of the church." Everyone had to take that oath. Everyone had to practice in the Church of England. Now, when we think of this, the oath of supremacy goes back to the time of Henry VIII. 1534, Henry VIII has his difficulties with the Holy Father not granting a divorce from his legitimate wife, Catherine of Aragon, to marry his impregnated Anne Boleyn. So Henry says, "I will make myself head of the church." Well, as time goes on, his successors, Edward VI and also Elizabeth I, imposed very grievous sanctions against the Catholic Church. The Catholic Church was illegal. It had to go underground. So everyone had to take this oath of supremacy. If a person did not attend Church of England services once a year and receive Holy Communion in that church service, that person was fined severely. If a person had Mass of the Roman Catholic Church in their home and harbored a priest, that person could be martyred for high treason, sentenced to death, like St. Margaret Clitheroe was. If a priest was found offering Mass in England, he would be charged with high treason and hung, drawn, and quartered, meaning hung until you're unconscious, cut down while you're still conscious now, and disemboweled, cut into four pieces. There are many priests who were martyred this way, like St. Edmund Campion, and we could go on and on. But that was life. Now, the church survived in this underground way because some of the wealthy Catholic families were able to pay fines. They had chapels. They had priests that they could hide and specially built hiding holes. If you ever get to go to England, look up some of these homes. They still have these hiding holes preserved. So the church somehow continued to survive. But all these penalties overflowed to Virginia. In 1642, the House of Burgess, by the promotion of Governor Berkeley, passed what was called the Act Against Papists and Priests. Meant that anyone who practiced the Catholic faith, any priest caught in Virginia, would be arrested, maybe executed. Part of this was prompted by the settlement of Maryland. Maryland, at first, was a colony of religious freedom. And so Governor Berkeley had this idea that there'd be this invasion of Catholics coming across from Maryland into Virginia. Well, it didn't happen, but nevertheless, this was the situation. Then comes the Puritan Revolution by Oliver Cromwell. Maryland and other places have their religious freedom taken away. Everything now is under the control of the crown. Life goes on. Giles Brent, who was a prominent member of the Maryland government, actually comes over to Virginia with his family. If any of you are familiar with the area of Aquia Harbor in Virginia, Stafford County, then that's where the Brent family settled. And they were known as Catholics, but even by this time, some colonists were starting to look the other way. The laws weren't always enforced, but nevertheless, they were on the books. There's a brief respite when King James II comes to power. He's a Catholic. He rules from 1685 to 1688. He does pass the Act of Toleration, gives religious freedom to all people. But the nobility resents this because they think, well, they might lose their land. maybe their land that was stolen from the church by Henry VIII and given to them will go back to the church. So James II is deposed. William and Mary come to the throne. Now, the ironic part of this is King William III, Queen Mary II, William III is a Calvinist. He's a Presbyterian from Holland. So he is now head of the Church of England in England, and he's head of the Church of Scotland, which is Presbyterian in Scotland. Go figure that mess as it is. But either way, they pass what are called the Test Acts. So they pass these laws that say, not only do you have to take the oath of supremacy, you have to take a test. And the test is, do you support the Pope and his authority? Do you attend Catholic Mass? Do you believe in transubstantiation? If you answer yes to those three questions, any of them, you failed the test. Now, those same test acts were taken over to the colonies, including Virginia. So if you fail the test, you cannot own property or a gun or a horse. You cannot have your children sent abroad for education. You cannot vote. You cannot hold a civil position in government. You cannot be a witness. Now imagine that. If you're in this colony, given it's a colony, don't you think you need a horse and a gun? Just to live, just to protect yourself. So if you fail the test, this is what's going to happen to you. Nevertheless, people did come. Catholics still came. And we do know that somewhere between 1690 and 1700, Father Christopher Plunkett, who was a Franciscan missionary, came to Virginia. He came to offer Mass to the Catholic church, the very few Catholic families. He was arrested. He was sentenced to death. He was placed on a deserted island somewhere in the Chesapeake Bay. Probably doesn't exist anymore, but that's where he died. He's a martyr in Virginia. And so time goes on. So we have now this situation where to be a Catholic was really to give up your civil liberties. Nevertheless, as I mentioned, Catholics began to settle. Well, time goes on, and Catholics are being ministered to by Jesuits who would cross over from Maryland to, they had an underground church there, from Maryland, cross the Potomac, and they would have Mass in homes like the Brent family home, or later on in Alexandria. Now, Alexandria was founded in 1749, seaport town. And it was a small town compared to what we know Alexandria. So if you go down to Old Town Alexandria, you think of like King Street and Duke Street and so on. Well, think about 5 blocks wide, 5 blocks deep. That was basically Alexandria. So 1749. We do know that by 1770, Catholics had settled there. And down where today is St. Mary's Cemetery, which would have been all the woods, several blocks down, they had a little like log cabin, and that was their church. And Jesuits crossed the Potomac River, they had Mass there. If you drive along the Beltway and you're crossing the Wilson Bridge, you see this very old cemetery. So if you're heading into Maryland, it will be on your left. If you're coming into Virginia, it's on your right. That's Old St. Mary's Cemetery. And there's a plaque there that marks, this is where the secret Masses were held. But then if you go into Old Town on King Street, there's a building now called the Burke and Herbert Bank. Well, that was Colonel John Fitzgerald's home. He was a Catholic, a friend of General Washington, later General Washington's aide in the Revolutionary War. Colonel Fitzgerald had a secret chapel in his home. There's a plaque on the Burke and Herbert Bank that says Colonel John Fitzgerald's home. So this is where we are. So we're getting to the Revolutionary War period now. And our founding fathers knew that they wanted freedom, and they wanted freedom for everyone. They needed the support of everyone to make this revolution successful. And so even in Virginia, We have now, on June the 12th, 1776, 1 month before the Declaration of Independence, James Madison securing in the House of Burgesses the Declaration of Liberties, which read, "Religion, or the duty that we owe our Creator, and the manner of discharging it, can be directed only by reason and conviction, not by force or violence. And therefore, all men are equally entitled to the free exercise of religion, to the dictates of conscience. And that is the mutual duty of all to practice Christian forbearance, love, and charity toward each other." That was a revolutionary idea at the time. Well, we know we won the Revolutionary War, thank God. And in 1785, the House of Burgesses in Virginia passed the Act Establishing Religious Freedom. Now, at that time, and that's 3 years before the Constitution, at that time, there may have been 300 Catholics in Virginia, maybe 25,000 in all the 13 colonies. There were 24 priests that we know of, mostly in Maryland and Pennsylvania, that served all these Catholics. So we were a minority. But nevertheless, the church continued to grow. But the point of this is that this religious freedom is not something we can take for granted. Our founding fathers knew what it was to face persecution. One of the signers of the Declaration of Independence, Charles Carroll, was a Catholic. But even though he's in that assembly of our founding fathers, as a member of Maryland, a citizen of Maryland, he couldn't vote. He had no rights, and yet he's one of these prominent citizens who helped build our country. Well, go on from there. After the Revolutionary War, our founding fathers knew that the evil of religious persecution, and they knew also how important it was for us as a people to be a people of faith. They knew that our morality as a society was based on faith. For instance, George Washington, 1797, said, "It is the duty of all nations to acknowledge the providence of Almighty God, to obey His will, to be grateful for His benefits, and to humbly implore His protection and favor." John Adams, in 1798, said, "Our Constitution was made only for a moral and religious people. It is wholly inadequate to the government of any other." Thomas Jefferson said, "Can the liberties of a nation be thought secure when we have removed their only firm basis, a conviction in the minds and of the peoples that these liberties are a gift of God, that they are not to be violated without incurring His wrath?" Our founding fathers knew how important freedom of religion is, but also how important religion is in the life of our society as citizens. Thomas Jefferson did use that phrase, separation of church and state. And that was not meant to create this like hostility between church and state. It was meant as a protection. That was his intention when he wrote that. It was an intention whereby the church could exist freely without interference or control by the state, and yet the church would not be interfering with the state. Both would work to build up the common good. And that's the idea, that when we think of the role of the church, it is to help build up the common good. And that's also the role of government, to build up the common good. So with that then, we look at where we are today. So what's the problem? First problem, the political intelligentsia would like you to believe that we do not have freedom of religion. Instead, we have freedom of worship. That phrase was very popular during the last administration. President Obama and others many times said that we have freedom of worship. Well, what that means is I can do what I want in the four walls of my church and be free. But anything on the outside should be kept quiet. I should not be practicing. It shouldn't be public. The danger there is, when does the modern day Gestapo sit in my pews to monitor what I'm saying, just like they did in the time of Nazi Germany? So freedom of religion means that my life is really ruled by my faith. The word religion means rule. It's a guidance. So when I think of religion, yes, it means how I worship, but it governs my life. So the way I dress is part of my religion as a priest. When I talk to people, if I use theological language, language of faith, that's part of my religion. It's part of who I am. As the Catholic Church, the reason why we founded schools and hospitals, orphanages, soup kitchens, homes for the elderly, is because that's what Jesus told us to do. When we look at those corporal spiritual works of mercy, as we discussed at Mass, that's what we're supposed to do. That's living our faith. And that's really serving the whole good, isn't it? When we pause to think about that, when we think of like a Catholic school, that serves the public. This is sort of the irony. You know, we use that term public school, private school. Well, isn't every school really serving the good of the public? Should be. Just because we're a religious school doesn't mean we aren't serving the common good. We are. If we have a Catholic hospital, we're serving the common good. We aren't going to deprive someone treatment because the person's not Catholic. Yes, there's this overarching set of principles that govern how we operate that hospital, but still, it's serving the common good. So freedom of religion means that I am going to live my faith and live it publicly. Give you a couple of examples. Back in 2010, the government of the District of Columbia mandated that all agencies that provide adoptive services must also provide those services to gay and lesbian couples. So a gay and lesbian couple, two men, two women, could adopt a child through Catholic Charities. And Catholic Charities said, no, this goes against our religious belief. Our religious belief is that marriage is between a man and a woman, husband and wife, and the children ought to have a mom and a dad, that a child needs a good model, a masculine model, a feminine model. Makes sense. Now, there are other adoption agencies, right? You could go somewhere else, but the government said, you have to do this. And sadly, the archdiocese caved. They should have gone to court, but they caved. So we put ourselves out of business instead of fighting. We should have fought on the grounds of religious freedom. It's not as though you can't adopt children from other places. You could. But we have a right to have an adoption agency, and we have a right to live by our religious beliefs. Take the Little Sisters of the Poor, probably one of the most notorious cases of recent times. So here we have the Affordable Care Act of 2010, usually called Obamacare, and it requires employers to cover 20 types of FDA-approved contraceptives, part of which are what are called abortifacients, meaning that it expels a conceived embryo from the womb of the mother, something like the morning after pill. So, the poor little sisters of the poor. So, that's sort of funny, you use the adjective, poor little sisters of the poor. So, the Obama administration says, you have to do this for your employees. And the little sisters said, we're Catholic. We can't do that. We are going to provide these services, these contraceptive abortifacient services, to our employees. So the Obama administration came back and said, okay, well, you don't have to pay for it. We'll pay for it. but you still have to put it in your policy. And the little sister said, no, because that makes us complicit. We become an accomplice to this. This goes against our beliefs. Now, no one's forced to work for the Little Sisters of the Poor. You can find a job elsewhere. So if you want to work for the Little Sisters of the Poor, you buy into their principles, right? So just like if I were going to work at a kosher Jewish deli, I would expect, well, I don't serve pork. Makes sense. That goes against kosher law. Well, same thing here. But no, the Obama administration said, you have to do this, or we will fine you $70 million a year. $70 million a year. Well, the little sisters said, we can't do that. And I can tell you, because they come to my parish to collect every year, a special collection to help support their home down in Richmond, Virginia, St. Joseph's. And the sister superior, Mother Marie Edwards, said, we are planning to close if we have to. They had plans in place to close all their facilities in the United States. And I said, well, Mother, what are you going to do? And she said, well, we'll have to leave the country. We'll go back to France, where our home base is. Isn't that sad? Mother Lorraine, who is the superior in the United States, said, as Little Sisters of the Poor, we offer the neediest elderly of every race and religion a home where they are welcome as Christ. We perform this loving ministry because of our faith and cannot possibly choose between our care for the elderly poor and our faith. But we shouldn't have to. All we ask is that our right not be taken away. The government exempts large corporations and other religious ministries from what they are imposing on us. We just want to keep serving the elderly poor as we have always done for 175 years. Well, finally, it does go to the Supreme Court, and on May 16th, 2016, there is a ruling, in a sense. Keep in mind, Justice Scalia has died. So there's eight justices. Well, rather than really give a decision, the justices, in a way, punted. And they said, we'll return this to the lower court, and there has to be a way for the government to accommodate the Little Sisters of the Poor. The government even admitted this when they appeared before the justices in the Supreme Court. So in a way, the Little Sisters of the Poor had a reprieve, that they now did not have to worry. And again, Sister Lorraine said in all of this, all we ever wanted to do is serve the neediest among us as if they were Christ himself. We look forward to serving the elderly poor for another 175 years. But ask yourself this, what if the justice who replaced Justice Scalia was not Justice Gorsuch? What if it was someone like Ruth Bader Ginsburg or Kagan or Sotomayor? It could have been, goodbye, Little Sisters of the Poor. We will erode the right of freedom of religion. Consider that. And I even mentioned this in a homily right before the election. I said, if there's no other reason to vote, it's because the next president will decide who fulfills Justice Scalia's spot. And think of, if the election went a different way, you and I, as Catholics, might be back in the catacombs one day. So it's very important we fight for our religious freedom. Second problem, though, is we now live in a new age of what are the test acts. Remember, William and Mary imposed these test acts. So you had to take the oath of allegiance, oath of supremacy to the King and Queen of England. They are the heads of the church. And you had to state that, or at least answer the questions, do you support the authority of the Pope? Do you attend Mass? Do you believe in transubstantiation? If you say yes, you're out of a job. You've lost your rights. Well, today the test acts are more like this. Do you believe in freedom of choice, including abortion? Do you believe in contraception? Do you believe in same-sex marriage? Do you think that it is freedom of worship or freedom of religion? Are you a committed or orthodox Christian or Catholic? Now, these questions by our new thought police come up. And if you say yes to those, you're going to be designated as having some kind of phobia, like you're a homophobe or Islamophobe, whatever it may be, or you're going to be called intolerant because you are not agreeing with those who are the tolerant. Isn't that an oxymoron? So the tolerant are very intolerant to those who disagree. Case in point, the Senate Judiciary Committee, September 2017, interviews Amy Coney Barrett, who was nominated to fulfill a circuit court judgeship for the Seventh Circuit Court, federal level. She teaches law at Notre Dame University, very well respected, very erudite, would be a wonderful choice for a judge. But then we have the questioning by Senator Dianne Feinstein of California. She said, "The dogma lives loudly within you. Why is it so many of us on this side have this very uncomfortable feeling?" What's the uncomfortable feeling about? She's a committed Catholic. She believes in pro-life. She believes in marriage. And she has said that she would recuse herself if needed, but still, that's what she believes. So the uncomfortable feeling. Senator Dick Durbin of Illinois, who professes to be a Catholic, but he said to proposed Judge Barrett, "Are you an Orthodox Catholic?" Which I guess means that if you believe in the church's teaching about the sanctity of human life from conception to natural death, the sanctity of marriage between a man and a woman as husband and wife, the sanctity of the family of the mom and dad and kids, the sanctity of the dignity of every person, somehow that disqualifies you. Now, Senator Durbin, although he says he's a Catholic, doesn't believe in those things because he votes against all of those kinds of laws that preserve those values. And for that, his own bishop in Springfield, Illinois, has put him under a censure that he cannot receive Holy Communion anymore. Go figure. But that's the questioning. It's the new test acts. So if you're going to be committed to your faith, then you will be tested. If you answer wrongly, get ready. There will be those that say, "Oh, you're the intolerant one. You have some kind of phobia," and so on. So be it. The truth will set you free, as our Lord said. But we have to speak out. Pope Benedict said, "Evil triumphs when good people keep quiet." So if we reduce our religion to just four corners of a church, we're doomed. We have to be committed witnesses of the faith. So what do we do? Well, there's many things that we can do. Let's look at the Catechism. The Catechism, and this is paragraph 2242. "The citizen is obliged in conscience not to follow the directives of civil authorities when they are contrary to the demands of the moral order, to the fundamental rights of persons, or the teachings of the gospel. Refusing obedience to civil authorities when their demands are contrary to those of an upright conscience finds its justification in the distinction between serving God and serving the political community. Render therefore to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and to God the things that are God's. We must obey God rather than men." And what that means then is that we have to, as good citizens, use the means we have to express our faith and express and uphold and fight for what is true. So that could be voting, it could be petitioning, it could be marching, like we have the Right to Life March every January. It could be a little civil disobedience every now and then, a protest. Why not? It's time for these things to happen. Some examples. the football players at Dunmore High School in Pennsylvania were told that they could not pray before a football game. So they had been praying for years since the beginning of that school. And their coach was told that as an employee of the school system, he could not pray with his players. Well, and part of it was the school was threatened by this group called Freedom from Religion, atheist group. So you have these groups going around the country trying to eradicate Christianity. Keep that in mind. Well, so the school caves to them rather than fight it. Well, the poor coach says, I can't pray with you guys. The guys prayed anyway. The football team prayed anyway because they have freedom of religion, freedom of speech. The school can't take that away from you. A little civil disobedience can work wonders. Or we go to Louisiana. And back in 2011, same group, so this is the Freedom from Religion group, threatened a Louisiana school district that had a tradition of offering a prayer at graduation. And this had been a tradition. For years and years since the beginning of that high school, a student, before the graduation began, invoked a prayer. Well, because one person complained, atheist group says, change it or we'll sue you. School caves. Well, senior Lacey Ray Mattis got up and she offered the prayer anyway. A little civil disobedience. And why? She has freedom of religion and she has freedom of speech. We have another student, and this is good for you college students here to remember. Just this past March, this came up. A young man named Lake Engel, funny name, Lake, but Lake Engel, is a religion major at Indiana University in Pennsylvania. It's in Indiana, PA. So he had to take a course. It was Christianity 481. It's called Self, Sin, and Salvation. So crazy professor, after showing a 15-minute talk by a transgender ex-pastor, and then discussing issues like mansplaining, sexism from man, and male privilege, asked the women, the professor was a woman, asked the women in the class to share their thoughts. And none of the women students offered any response. So Lake Engel raised his hand, and he said that biologists officially say there are two genders, male and female. He was thrown out of the class. And the professor reported him to the Academic Integrity Board. Now, he needed that class to graduate. So if he's kicked out of the class, he's not going to graduate. So he threatens to sue on grounds of religious freedom and also freedom of speech. Engel said, "My professor is violating my First Amendment rights because of the fact that my views and ideology are different from hers." So she took it on herself to silence and embarrass me, bully me for speaking up in class. Well, fortunately, the college president intervened. He was reinstated, and he will graduate. But he had the guts to fight. He had the guts to open his mouth. If any of you haven't seen the movie God Is Not Dead, and this is the very first one, you ought to watch it, because that happens. Professors can be very intimidating. But remember, it's a matter of living your faith, being a witness to your faith. The word martyr means witness. We might ever never be physical martyrs, but if we're committed, we have to bear witness to what we believe and not be bullied by others. So what should you all do? What should you do, whether you're in high school or in college? Well, first of all, you need to know your faith and to believe it. That's the key. Personally, you need to know your faith. That's part of the intellect, but you have to believe it. You have to love Jesus. That's what it's about. That's the heart. So the intellect, the heart have to go together in this. But that's why in your own personal life, take the time to continue to learn your faith. Continue to read sacred scripture or the catechism, whatever it may be. Also pray. Have that identity with Christ. And I emphasize prayer because the Holy Spirit can empower you to bear witness and to have the strength to stand up to the bullies. That's what we need. We need strong leaders. And then you have to put it into action. So for instance, that action could be in your own school, organizing a Catholic club. Where Paulo is at Potomac Falls High School, some of our parishioners a few years ago organized a Catholic club. Now, if other people can have a club, why can't the Catholics have a club? They found a sponsor, they followed all the rules, regulations, they have a Catholic club, the Catholic Student Association, and they do some good service projects, they meet and so on, have that identity. It could be wearing the t-shirt that has some Christian value to it. That's part of your freedom of speech. Don't let someone bully you out of not wearing something religious. You could even be having the Ten Commandments on the front of your shirt. Could be having a big cross. Or some of our students also had these shirts made during the whole awful time when ISIS was killing so many in Iraq and Syria. These shirts that had it's an Arabic letter that the ISIS people would paint on a Christian home, and it standard for Christian, Nazarene. And that meant destroy the home, family, and so on. So we had these made, and just to bring interest or inform people that Christians are being persecuted by these ISIS people in these countries. So with that, too, you have to also think, how do you act? So it's not just like having a club or having this overt demonstration, but how do you act? Nietzsche, who is that very sad, miserable atheist philosopher of the 1800s, was having a conversation, like a debate with someone who was a Christian, and he said to the person, how can you expect me to believe in Christ when you don't even act like he's risen from the dead? Good point. We have to live it. So how do you talk? How do you interact with others? How do you dress? We have to live our faith fully. If we really want to make a statement in this world, we have to be different, in a good sense, and bring about a conversion of others. But then, too, don't be afraid of defending your faith. A couple of students that I've known. One student went to a very prominent high school in Fairfax County, and he was in his government class, and the teacher started talking about, well, what do you think about, marriage between two men, two women? So same-sex marriage kind of thing. And most of the students said nothing. A few said, well, I agree with that. It's all this, this, and that. And he said, I disagree. Marriage is between a man and a woman. Silence. Until this book came flying across the room and hit him from a person who disagreed and called him intolerant. Who's intolerant? The person who threw the book's intolerant, when you think about it. So he goes down to the principal's office, and the principal, of course, punishes the student, like, don't throw books now. And for him, though, you shouldn't be talking that way. You're upsetting people. Well, the truth is upsetting. Too bad. But so be it. I know another young lady, she's now at the University of Virginia, but during her time in high school, she had a Western civilization teacher who must have been an atheist as well as ignorant. Probably both go hand in hand. But this teacher said, first of all, St. Paul was the first pope. Excuse me, it's St. Peter. No, it wasn't. St. Paul. It's St. Peter. Teacher had to look it up and had to admit, made a mistake. And then it was, Constantine founded the Catholic Church. Excuse me, Jesus founded the Catholic Church. Look in the books. And then it was, this was a real pip, that When Our Lady of Guadalupe appeared in 1531, the Catholic Church canonized her. Excuse me, that was our Blessed Mother Mary, Mother of Jesus. She's all holy. She was a saint long before 1531. Pius XII was anti-Semitic. Excuse me, Pius XII saved 800,000 Jews. He was surrounded by June 1940 by Nazis. He had no one to support him. And the New York Times said in December of that year that he's the lonely voice crying out for the plight of the Jews. Well, God bless her, but she was prepared. She knew her stuff. She had it up here. She had it in here. And that's what we need to be. Because if we aren't that way, they're going to walk all over us. And before you know it, we become the slaves of the political correctness. And there's the ideology. Pope Benedict, again, said that we live right now in a dictatorship of moral relativism. And that means that the truth is whatever the ruling power decides it to be. That's dangerous, where there's no more right or wrong, no more true or false, no more good or evil. Moral relativism, it's all about what I think is true, good, and right. And when that's the case, whoever has power will use the logic of power to impose that upon everyone else. You will believe what I want you to believe. That's where we are today, especially when we look at the news media. But instead, you and I have to be the fighters for freedom of religion and all freedom. Again, remember what President Reagan said. Freedom is never more than one generation from extinction. You all now have the great task, whether you're in high school or you're in college, to ensure as best you can that our religious freedom, our freedom of religion, and all of our freedoms are safe and secure for your kids. Good luck. God bless you. All right.
We have time for questions. Please light up the microphone.
Scared you all off, huh? No. Uh-oh. You might tell me, like, where you're from or something, too, so I can pick on you or do something.
Well, I'm my name is Ryan Wormstaller, and I'm from the great Golden State of California.
Oh, I have relatives there, too, so. Land of fruits and nuts. Right? Then you get to know what that is.
Well, I also go to.
I see that in church sometimes.
I also go to college in Vermont, home of Bernie Sanders. So.
Oh, there you go.
Not much change there. But my question is, in an age where a revitalization of reason through a lot of philosophers and intellectuals such as Steven Pinker and Sam Harris, God forsake him. How do we bring back religion in American society and also in the lives of the Western culture, considering that there is the fundamentalism being reinvigorated? How can we bring back Catholicism? Because there is a decline in numbers.
Yeah, there is a decline in Catholicism. And it's sad that the second largest Christian denomination is lapsed, fallen away Catholic. In our country. That's disturbing. Well, I always look at it as you think of how 12 apostles went out and converted a pagan Roman Empire. So we might be in some ways contracting, and there's many reasons for that. It could be the abuse of what is called Vatican II at times, like this was Vatican II when it really wasn't. It could be the poor religious education that occurred especially in the late 60s, 70s, and so on. But nevertheless, we have to start now. So I look at my parish and I see many good young families. And they're raising their children the right way. And that's how we change it. Because given this day and age, where you look at the problems in society, here we have so much in our country, and we have really so many freedoms in a way, why are people so unhappy? You know, why is it? You know, I look at my own parish. Why is it in Loudoun County we have one of the highest teenage suicide rates? And we're one of the wealthiest counties in the country? Or why is it we have an opioid epidemic in our country? Why are people so miserable? They're lacking God. So if they see someone like you who joyfully lives the faith, I mean, that's the key of it. You know, really joyfully love your faith. And they see these young families, they're going to say, well, that's what I want. That's how you bring about converts. That's how the apostles converted the Roman Empire. Because people want more than what we're offering right now. So it starts in the ground. It starts in the home. Good marriages, good homes. And then you have to have good parishes, too. But that's what you need. And I think one of the great things that happened, that has happened three times in my parish time here at Our Lady of Hope, we've had teenagers come into the church at the Easter Vigil. And these teenagers came from a home that had no religion. But the teenager knew a good Catholic teenager that loved his or her faith. And that's what prompted them. So it can happen. People are looking. They want something more than just what this society offers.
Thank you.
Sure.
Hi, Father. I'm Joe Mendez. I also go to St. Michael's College and the least religious state in the Union, but I'm from Western Massachusetts. My question for you is if you think there's any hope for our hierarchy to censure Catholic so-called politicians who support intrinsic evils like abortion and homosexuality and things like that, and contraception. And so do you think there's any hope for them to censure that? And do you think it would, you know, be appropriate to even go more extreme and say, instead of just denying Holy Communion, like under Canon 915, to excommunicate or interdict the districts, for example?
Yeah, that's a hard question, because I would hope that bishops, given the graces that God does give to them at their episcopal bishop ordination, they would have the fortitude to do something like that. Unfortunately, we haven't seen much of it. It's sad. And you do have some bishops, like I mentioned, the bishop in Springfield, Illinois, and Bishop Bruskowitz, when he was the Bishop of Lincoln, took such action, but it's sad that more don't. I don't know why. They have the power to do it. And part of the problem is that we've let it go for so long, going back to the 60s even. We could go on, talk about a lot of different things that happened in Massachusetts in the 60s. But it's really too bad, because I think because our bishops have not taken such action, that a lot of people, they have lost some of their credibility. And that's not good. So, and even some priests, hate to say it, some priests don't preach about moral issues. I don't know what goes on in your parishes, but some would rather talk about love, 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 and neighbor, 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 but they don't really talk about right or wrong moral issues. And that's what we're supposed to do. And we have to teach people. And you can teach the truth with compassion. That's very important. But still, we have to teach the truth. So, I don't know. You look at Pope John Paul II. What a great man. What he did. I was a senior in college when he was elected in 78. He died in 2005. He did so much good for the church to turn it around, so much different than what it was when I was your age. And as far as teaching, liturgy, so many things. And Pope Benedict, another great, brilliant pope. So we can only hope, and there is hope, but we can only hope that we'll continue to have good leadership. But not an easy solution. Yeah. But it's very frustrating. For instance, Cardinal Dolan recently in the Wall Street Journal wrote an editorial about how the Democratic Party has left the Catholic Church, something like that. where in the times of the big immigration and so on, the Democratic Party was very much open to Catholics and the immigrants who were coming to this country. This goes back to the 30s and 40s and so on. Well, Cardinal Dolan writes this nice piece about the Democratic Party and its state and condition and how it's left the Catholic Church. But has he ever censured anybody in New York City? No. What do you do? It's like they talk one way, they act a different way sometimes. So we can only hope that the talking and the actions work together. Of course, I'm not at that level, probably never will be, so I just offer my opinion. I don't know if that helps at all.
Little known part of the Episcopal consecration to write up the removal of the backbone.
Mm-hmm. Oh, the removal.
At least in some cases.
I've heard of that. Yes, you're welcome.
Hello, my name is Noah Burdett, and I'm from Regina Luminous Academy outside of Philadelphia. You spoke about moral relativism, and I would add that like self-determined values have replaced divinely ordained virtues. Mm-hmm. Concerning the ubiquity of moralistic therapeutic deism, what would you say are like the societal ramifications of such a pervasive and constructed religion?
I'm not sure I understand the question.
What are the societal ramifications of moralistic therapeutic deism?
Moralistic therapy deism?
Therapeutic.
What is it? I've never heard that term.
It's a like a feel-good religion that people...
Oh, a feel-good.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, it's really self-idolatry, isn't it? When you think about it, if it's a feel-good religion, it's like I'm worshiping me. I feel good about me. I'm perfect the way I am. Oh, good, look at me kind of thing. You know, I'll make up my own truth. I'll make up my own values and so on. So if I think euthanasia's okay and abortion's okay and so on, but I love save the whales, God forbid you hear a whale, or, you know, save the darter snail fish or whatever it is, you know, all those hug a tree. So you have all these things. It's really like a self-idolatry. And when you have self-idolatry, you're going to destroy yourself. It's like the Narcissus thing. Mm-hmm. You will destroy yourself. Aristotle said the slightest deviation from the truth leads to infinite mistakes. And he's right. So we have to start with truth. But truth is not something way out there. Truth is God. And God has revealed his truth. And God has perfectly revealed that truth in the incarnation of Jesus Christ, who said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. So I conform my life to Christ and what he has revealed. So God's Ten Commandments aren't suggestions, and they aren't multiple choice. God's commandments are commandments to keep us on the right path, to live now, and we believe to be with him in heaven. And we go from there. But if it's left up to me, I'm doomed. If it's all about me, I can feel great, but I am doomed. But why is it that, look at our society then. If people say, oh, well, I feel so good about myself and so on, and this,
therapeutic deism.
Good heavens, holistic. Yeah, you wonder who thinks up these things, you know, these titles. I mean, really, they must be smoking something to think up a title like that. I'm serious. Then why is it we have things like doctor-assisted suicide, or again, the opioids, and so on? If everyone's so happy, why is the suicide rate for young people so high? Makes no sense. You think they'd be wanting to live. So it's not fulfilling at all. It's not very wholesome. It's not very therapeutic. And the deism part is they're worshiping themselves.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay. Hi,
if this gets out, I'm probably doomed. You know that? I mean, if you put this on the national news. So, live streaming.
Yeah. My name's Anna Lulis. I'm from Liberty University.
And my Which university?
Liberty.
Liberty.
And my question is, how do you think we should reform CCD in order to make it more engaging for
Reform
young
what?
CCD.
Oh, Okay, religious ed?
Yes, in order to engage young Catholics, because I know a lot of Catholics leave the church or become unpracticing after confirmation.
Mm-hmm.
So what are your thoughts on that, and like how could
we... Well, that's a real complicated question, because we religious education programs meet maybe once a week for maybe an hour and a half a week, and you're relying on volunteers to teach. So you have these variables, which already are not setting the stage for great success. How can you teach something just as important as our faith in just 1 hour, 15 minutes a week? And then you have a volunteer who might be doing a great, or putting forth a great effort, but might not be the best teacher. So that's a problem. A lot depends upon the home. There's the key. What's going on in the home? Because no matter if a child goes to Mass every Sunday and goes to religious ed 1 hour and 15 minutes a week, but if the parents at home are not praying with the children and living the faith and teaching that faith and really trying to make that home a little church, like Pope St. John Paul II said, that child's not going to get the faith. A wise old professor of mine, this is when I was doing my doctoral work, said that values are not just taught, they are caught, meaning they are caught. So you can have the best teacher for religious ed, 1 hour and 15 minutes, and you might have the most dynamic pastor at Mass on Sunday, but if it's not lived at home, it's not going to get caught, most likely. And that's the problem. Yeah, I really think that's the problem, because I know people, I know just from my experience as a pastor, that the kids do go through religious ed, and they might go to Mass, but other than that, it's not being lived. It's like scattershot. Families don't eat together. It's like moms and dads are bus drivers, go here, go there, so on. There's really no time for God. And so how is a child going to experience God and God's love?